Charlotte, who was going to be baptized this morning, got sick. And so she's not going to be able to be here to be baptized. We're hoping for another day, and hopefully that'll work out. So, but we also have our graduates here, and we're going to be giving them their quilts today, and kind of ushering them away, supporting them as they go off into new adventures. Then other announcements are as follows. Don't forget, we have, at this time we're collecting supplies for school kits, and if you are at the Walmart, you notice all of a sudden the prices are pretty good, and you want to pick up a few notebooks or crayons or whatever, please do so, bring them here to the church. We'll make sure when the time comes we get those to the designated areas. So thank you for doing that. And then a couple of other things. We have on August 19th is our annual steak fry. A little more information is going to be coming, but just kind of wetting your palates for that. So be ready to participate in that and invite some friends. It's a wonderful meal, and it's a good time to share some time together. We are sharing a little more time together, so that's good for us. Then an announcement about Holy Communion. We're just recognizing how difficult it is for us to remain as safe as we can be. So Holy Communion this morning, as you come forward, I invite you to place your hand out. Indicate, if you are going to have gluten-free, please indicate that prior to receiving the bread and the wine. But I will be taking the bread, I will have my gloves on, bread, and dip it in the wine, and you will receive both in kind at that time. So just place your hand out so that the bread can be placed into your hand. I don't think I have other announcements today, so please, if there are announcements, let me know right away. Anything else that we need to announce today? If not, thank you very much. At this time, we begin our worship service with the praise music.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace let us pray to the Lord.
When the Israelites saw it,
answered our monitors. And let us join in the reading of the psalm. I invite you to join in the bold letter verses. Psalm 78. So God commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven.
Rain down manna upon the trees, and gave them rain from heaven.
The mortals ate the bread of angels. God provided for them enough food.
The Lord caused the east wind to blow in the heavens, and powerfully led out the south wind.
Raining down flesh upon them like dust, and flying birds like the sand of the seas.
Let them fall in the midst of the camp, and round about the dwellings.
So the people ate, and were well filled, for God gave them what they craved. Would you please rise? God is that which comes down from heaven to give life to the world. they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I was thinking I might have some young kids with baptisms going on, but I don't. So I turn my attention once again to our virtual audience, which we have done for as long as I can remember now, over a year and a half. That's about as far as my memory goes back, by the way, in case you're wondering. So we're happy that we have people who are with us today. And I've been kind of putting things on this little table, kind of enticing people to think about what we might be doing. And can you imagine what I have on here today? Having known the text now, it is, that's right, a loaf of bread, which I was able to bake yesterday. I baked two loaves. One we consumed rather quickly. The other I saved for this occasion. And I was hoping, therefore, to be able to kind of share it, but we're not in the sharing mood these days, especially food, much less air. So you just have to know that I'm here and this loaf of bread is here, and you don't get to taste it. Although, are you smelling it at all? Does anybody have a little whiff of that bread? I was really hoping I could take it out of the oven and bring it this morning, but the bread rose too quickly, so I had to go ahead and bake it yesterday. Anyway, my point is this, that bread is one of those things that sustains us. It is there, it is a staple of our diets, and it's an important ingredient to what keeps us healthy and alive. But even more so if you were living back in Jesus' time. The bread of life, the image of the bread of life, must have conjured up some pretty immediate kind of responses, because probably that was something that they ate immediately and every day. So I just wanted to kind of make that statement, especially for young kids, of how important it is that we see Jesus as this life-giving bread for us. The other thing that I realize is that often in the scriptures, it talks about eating the word, that the word is tasty for us, and we consume the word, and our Bibles have that bread of life, that word of God, which is a life-giving word for us, and we are meant to eat that and sustain our lives in that bread, in that word. I like that idea. I like the idea of tasting the word of God. As a young person, I've mentioned before, the Bible is one of the first books I ever read from cover to cover. I hate to say it, I didn't really enjoy reading a whole lot. Somebody else with me, it was not my big thing. It took me to get a little more mature, a little older, which I think is part of our text, getting mature, right? Becoming mature, and I think that was a part of that. But this idea, then, that the Word of God sustains and keeps us. That's an important image for us. So today we're going to talk about a little bit of what Jesus is talking about when he says, "I am the bread of life." But for my younger audience, I want you to think of taking and savoring the words that God gives to us in the scriptures, how important they are. So take a moment. I ask mom or dad to read it if you're too young to read yourself. But find that word and make it a part of your daily life. Okay, so that's my message for today. Now that I've spoken over this bread, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to take it home. If you really want some, we'll have to talk about having a baking night here at the church. But tonight, this one's going home with me, so sorry about that. Well, good morning. How is everybody today?
Morning.
I think this is our biggest crowd since we opened up again. I am so happy with that. It is good to see people out there in the midst. So I'm just going to say, may the grace and peace of God be with us today. Amen. Now, I want to build a little bit. You know, whenever I do a children's message, you adults are already well. You know me, right? I mean, I'm going to start using that as a stepping stone for other things. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be building off of my children's message today. I can't help but notice something about this particular thing that we're doing. and that is later in the service, I was hoping that we would have a baptism. Little Charlotte was going to be baptized, and then also today we're recognizing our graduates. So I've got Tyler and Jacob here as well, and they're graduating from high school. I can't help but notice those two ends of life a little bit, you know. Young life just starting out, not end of life for you guys, but kind of a stepping stone, luckily, right? Not the end of your life, but a stepping stone for something else. And that somehow God is here with us and inviting us into this relationship with Him from the very first breath of our life through those stepping times in our life and to the very end of life. I've also had a funeral Friday. I've got another one coming up on Tuesday. And looking at these places where God feeds us and is with us, that's an important thing. So the other thing that's kind of important is that we would have given the shawl to little Charlotte today, which she's going to get, by the way. I'm not denying Charlotte that. No matter what happens to little Charlotte, she's getting that shawl, okay? So that's not going to happen. But then for the guys, our two graduates who have their quilts are going to be giving to us. And I can't help but remember the funeral pall that was placed over the urn on Friday. And looking at these things that are repeated to remind us again of God's protection and God's constant involvement in our daily lives. What we hope is that there will be a reminder that goes with the graduates today, a reminder that will go with little Charlotte that reminds us of the sustaining power of the Word of God to nourish our faith and our life. And so we will pray about that a little bit later. We will be doing some prayers for our graduates. We will probably lift a little Charlotte up in our prayers also. But we will pray that this mark of our faith, these moments that mark our life in Christ, are not private matters, but they are very public matters, as a funeral becomes a very public statement about what we believe God does with us in death. What God does for us as we are baptized into Christ, what God does with us as we make transitions in life that He is sustaining us. Life in Christ is not a private matter, but something that is seen and shows the body, whole body of Christ, that we are in this venture as one body. Which is the second text for today, right? The lesson. We are one body in Christ. There's one baptism. There's one way to live, and it is in Christ together with each other. I'd like to go a little bit deeper then into the lesson for today. Again, it's important to remember that the feeding of the 5,000 has just occurred. That was last week. It's important to remember that the crowd of hungry people are not just, we're not just hungry back then, but are going to get hungry again. That's an important piece to remember. Because hunger is like that, especially for some of us, right? I feel like I'm hungry on a continual basis. It's like I had a piece of toast this morning with some strawberry jam. Guess what? I'm already hungry. I'm already kind of hoping that when this service is done and you guys all leave, you go to your car, you go and you leave, that piece of bread, that's mine. Okay, that's not making sure. That's mine. I'm going to make sure that's consumed immediately. There is something about that idea, then, of the bread of life. The looking on it, the smelling of it, and the tasting of it. Could it be that that is one of the reasons why Jesus says, I am the bread of life? Could it be why Jesus teaches us to pray, give us today our daily bread? Not just like one time kind of bread, not the one kind of little morsels, but until you're full, but again and again and again. Is it not true that God wants to be close to us, giving daily life to us? Not just the heavens where we are with God somewhere in our distant futures, hopefully most of us in our distant futures, but His holy presence, this daily life. His holy presence, that like our daily bread, is something we crave and we long for because we know that it sustains us. Now, there's a background story to this New Testament story, Jesus talking about being the bread of life. And it's also something that is very revealing to us, right? It's the story of the Exodus. It's the first lesson for today. And exposes sides of our lives we often wish it were being untold or unretold. So, okay, I've heard it once. I don't want to have to hear it again. The people of Israel had long suffered under the oppression of the Egyptian pharaohs. Their freedom and escape was no small thing. Moses led them with signs that can only be characterized as miracles. First, the plagues, the first nine, but especially that last deadly plague, right? When Israel avoided death by sprinkling blood of the slaughtered lamb on their doorpost. Next was the escape by the sea, where the sea swallowed up the Egyptian army that was pursuing them, while Moses and Israel were able to escape to dry land and go on to the promised land. But the story doesn't end. In the wilderness, starving and afraid, they beg Moses to give them food to eat. And when Moses goes to God to intercede for them, God sees their need and gives them manna, bread from heaven. But again, that's not the end of the story. It doesn't take long before, once again, the people are what? They're complaining. They're complaining. They had food, they had quail, they had been satisfied. But what were they complaining about? Now this bread alone is not enough. They wanted more. They wanted variety. They remembered slavery life, and they wished to return to slavery living. If only they could go back and eat from the flesh pots and the leeks and the onions. Not this manna. What is manna to eat? Now, this story is real, but it's a lesson that is even more real. It's true, Jesus is our daily bread, but escaping our slavery to all the pleasures of this life is not so easily done. Comparison, our world is full of all sorts of pleasurable things that call us back into slavery living and sin, or anything that lures us away from our source of life, abundant life in Christ. This statement that I am the bread of life goes deep into our fears about not having enough, our fears about taking what we want, including things that are not life-giving for us, and finally our fears that variety is the spice of life. What we now recognize in Jesus' statement is something we are constantly battling. It's the definite article, the thought. Jesus is the bread of life. Jesus isn't saying, I am one of the life-giving breads in your life. He's not saying, I hope you enjoy my bread as much as you enjoy that other bread. He's not saying, I hope you like this bread instead of that bread. He's saying, I am the bread of life. I am the one and only life-giving bread. If you seek life, I am that life. And that is what we most fear, is it not? That the Jesus of the cross and the Jesus of the empty tomb is making an exclusive statement, one which we would like to ignore or somehow water down. But here it stands. If you want the bread of life, here I am. Here it is. So the statement comes again to us today. Come eat. Come often. Come daily. Come hungry. Come tired. Come broken. Come afraid. Come confessing. Come seeking. Come. and there is none other than me. Peace be with you. Amen. Let us join in our hymn of the day, and we can stand on the left. Just for the last verse.
Feed those who are hungry, reassure those who are despairing,
and accompany those who are in prison. Rain down the true bread from heaven that gives life to the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You receive all who come seeking a sign of grace. Make this congregation a place of hospitality for those accustomed to rejection, to those who have felt excluded here or elsewhere. Prepare us to welcome them in the name of Christ. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You provide food that endures for eternal life. Sustain us each day with the bread of life until we are gathered with those, all the saints, who feast together at your heavenly banquet. And now today we just offer our prayers for the family of Ed Lundstrom. Be with Barb and her boys and kids and grandkids. Be with Jim's family at his funeral. I watch over Steve and his mother and his sister and their families. Be with them. Watch over little Charlotte today. Even though she feels sick, may you bring your healing power and your grace into her life. And watch over both Tyler and Jacob, and we'll be bringing their names before you again a little bit later. But we lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
At this time, I invite you to be seated. And I'm actually going to invite our graduates to come forward at this time. Tyler and Jacob. Just see, you guys stay down there. You're too tall for me. And what I mean by that, if you want to come right over here, what I mean by that is these are my two, I probably still fell short. These are my two tallest compliments for a long time, and it's good to have you both here today. It is our delight, really, and our honor to have you here as graduates of high school. It's almost impossible to believe that it's possible. We are very proud of you. It is a privilege to affirm, as members of this congregation, your life in this congregation and the life that you are going to be leading and directing in the future. You have completed what is a pretty monumental part of your milestone in your lives, and I hope that you look back on this time at Kenwood as a great way of being with you during those years as you came to this milestone. So I'm going to ask you to affirm your commitment to a life of faith in the body of Christ today. That is what our hope is. And so I'm going to ask you a few questions, and the responses, you'll remember this, with God's help, I do. So you can also look up on the monitors, because I think they've got all of that up there as well. So graduates, as you celebrate your achievements and prepare for new endeavors, you thank God for the many ways your faith has been your strength and guide. If so, respond with God's help, I do.
With God's help, I do.
And as you consider your next step and journey in life, you acknowledge God as going with you, before you, behind you, below and above you, and also within you. If so, respond with God's help, I do.
With God's help, I do.
As you make choices about your new endeavors, will you offer your gifts to the world as a part of the body of Christ and welcome the support of your family of faith? If so, again, respond with God's help, I will.
With God's help, I will.
Now I'm going to invite you to stand as a congregation, as you are able, because this is not a private matter, is it? It is a very public statement we are making. So people of Kenwood Lutheran Church, do you claim these graduates as brothers in Christ, called to ministry according to their talents? If so, let us respond, in God's love, we claim them.
In God's love, we claim them.
As their home congregation, do you promise to support them, take an interest in their future, to be with them in their celebrations and in their sadnesses, to welcome them whenever they return to Kenwood Lutheran Church? If so, let us respond, in God's love, we support them. You promise to faithfully pray for these brothers in the faith and placing their futures into God's loving hands as they make their choices. If so, In God's love, we pray for them. So let us pray. Gracious God, you bless your servants with many achievements. We give thanks, especially today, for the milestones that these graduates have attained. As they begin new phases of their lives, may they know your love in all the experiences that they have. Bless their parents. Watch over them. Be with them. And as students who have raised their children and nourished them in the Christian faith, give the parents strength in their holy presence and give them many joyful reunions with these sons, those who are leaving home to go far away, and those staying close. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Just remain standing for a little bit longer. I've got only one more thing to do. I love you, sir. Well, you can only do one of two things, and I'm not sure if there is a...
This one comes to you, sir.
And now, what we're supposed to do is open this up, but it's tied so nicely, I don't think I'm going to get it untied. But I want you to consider, both of you, that you have, thank you again, that I have opened these up and you have, it's so hot, I understand, that you are draped in those wonderful, I said, I have about a year and a half, my memory's, yeah, that's still there. Those quilts, because, and the nice thing is you can take it with you. I don't know if you're going to end up in a dorm thing, I think, whatever. I haven't heard exactly where you're going yet, but it's going to be there. And I hope it's a visual piece that you are covered in the love of this congregation and, more importantly, the love of Christ. May that image not escape you today and in the future. So here is our final words to you. Jacob and Tyler, go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the fainted hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you for being with us today. You guys can go back. As you get ready to sit down, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also.
And you can move around, share the peace of Christ, even with them in appropriate ways. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very own self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body, Let us join in the great thanksgiving.
Direction.
Let us rise. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The blessing of Almighty God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. We continue with our sending hymn number 655. 655.